We are now going to kind of put our stick into the wheel of the open source community, because we're going to talk about reviewing code and why the more eyeballs on the code is not a good thing. Well, it's a good thing, but why it don't work in practice? Because first of all, we don't know how many eyeballs there are on the code. I always say this to my friends that are raving about open source and eyeballs on the code. Okay, how much time a day do you spend looking at said code? How many times do you look at other people's source code? Here's the thing, you cannot be a developer of the software. It needs to be people outside of the development circle, because that's what they're talking about with eyeballs on the code. Or you're not affiliated with, let's say, the software that you're looking at. You need to be from the outside in. Because if you are a developer within the program that you're looking at the source code on, it's the same as proprietary software. The developers that are developing the program are all looking at the source code, or, you know, their teams looking at different parts of the source code, just like you're doing with your program. So you need to not be part of the dev team or have any association with the dev team at all. If you do it, how many of your friends have done it over the last year? How much time have you spent on it, and so on and so on? And most people say, I've never done it. I don't know anyone that's done it beside the core development team or people associated with the product or project, sorry, AKA the same fucking thing as they do on the proprietary software development. So let's dive into why having random people that have no knowledge or intimate knowledge about the code, looking at the code, probably is not as great as you think it is. So, what is a code reviewer or a code review? A code review is also known as peer code review. It involves one or more team members checking another teammate's work. This involves viewing changes made to the source code before they are implemented into the code base. And then it's talk about why, but this is really interesting. 9 code reviews best practices, and this is done to be these best practices is to make sure that you are the most optimal at your job for the long period of time, let's say 5 to 8 hours. Know what to look for in the code review. So if you're looking at a code, and we're going to look at some code here in a bit, but if you're looking at a code for GIMP and you are a GNOME developer or you are a KDE developer, you don't know what to look for because you don't have intimate knowledge about. There's a lot of common, you know, everyday use things that you can use, you know, coding is a lot of the same paradigms and stuff like that. So you can, you know a little bit, but you don't have intimate knowledge about why they're doing X, Y, and Z the way they're doing it. And that can also mean that you probably are not a really good code review because you are not part of the team. You don't really know what to look for. Build and test before review. Don't review code for longer than 60 minutes. Why? Because your brain gets basically overworked. You need a break. It's like reading a book and remember everything you read in a book for 60 minutes. Check no more than 400 lines of code at the time. DJ Ware, if you watch this out there, he can say how many lines of code a human can review on a day, because he commented on one of my other videos, something like it would take like decades for one person to review the source code for the kernel. Here's the problem, because you guys would say, oh, just 2 small people. Yeah, but then you get into another problem. They may not pick up what you pick up. More people don't mean better work. You get what I'm saying here? Too many cooks in the kitchen don't mean better cooking. Give feedback that helps, not hurt. Communicate goals and experience. So again, you need to understand the expectations. You need to understand what the project want, what the code base want, and so on and so on. Include everyone in the code review process. So if I'm sitting at home here and I'm looking at code, I kind of need to talk to the developer. I can't just sit here and say, oh, fix this, I have a fix for it. Yeah, your fix may go in and mess around with other objects in the code base, other functions or variables in the code base. So you may think it works, and it may work on your machine, but it may also include bugs in other parts of the code that you have not tested yet. Again, build and test before review and stuff like that. Foster a positive culture, automate to save time. So you can automate a lot of code reviews, but it's not 100% foolproof. How many lines of code in the Linux kernel? Around 27.8 million. It's more efficiently done with people that have intimate knowledge of the code, that have their fucking dicks and panties in the development team, and not some random fucking person on the internet. Let's look at some code. Let's go on here to, what is this? Kmail. Remember, 60 minutes and 400 lines of code at one time. This is Gmail's CMakeList. This is just a text file. But if you want to look at this here, This is it's already over the limit of what you should review in one setting to be efficient. Plus, you need to understand or have knowledge about all of the fucking source files that are here in the subfolders. You need to understand this before you can be efficient. You don't need to be an expert, but you need to understand it. At least you need to understand the source code that you're looking at here. And when you're asking them, what happens if I change this? What happens if I change something like down here? You can't just change it. You have to like, okay, you that are like the, you know, a manager or something, like, what happens if I change this? And then he has to go and talk to some other people, say, oh, well, you can change it, but it will probably give you a bug in this source file. And then you have to figure that one out or review that source file. You get what I'm saying here. And again, there are ways to automate this, don't get me wrong, but automation still to this day in 2022 is not like the end all and be all. It's another source file. This is under the 400 lines of code that you can review. You need to have some knowledge about what's going on with the rest of the project. Again, you don't need to be an expert in all the other source files, but you need to have some knowledge about it. Just because you sit at home and you're like, okay, I try and change this number here. Oh, now my program works on your machine. Yeah, may do. But if you then compile it and test it on an AMD machine, or you compile and test it on a server, or you compile and test it on some, like let's say you're using KMail on the GNOME, now you have a fucking problem. That's all the things that you need, you know, if you're intimate with the development team and you talk with the development team, you have great communication. Because a lot of people, I've seen a lot of people, oh, I have a fix for this, you know, and I send it to the developers and it's not being implemented. And they get angry. You know, have you asked them why it's not being implemented? You know, they had their own version of it, yet it's probably because your version introduced some incompatibilities or bugs that they fixed with their version of the code that they are working on, because they have knowledge, intimate knowledge. They're coddling and festering and sending love letters to the code all day and all night. You are not. Let's look at the console here, the terminal. Not that many. This is the source code file that we're in here. Let's just look at this file here called emulation.h. We already over the 400 lines of code that you should look at once. That means that you should look at this and take a break. How long those breaks should be? 10, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, I don't know. But you need a break. And plus, you need to have an intimate knowledge, or not a great knowledge, but you need to understand or talk to people that understand what's going on with all of this stuff here also. It's another file. It's the terminal display CPP. Reviewing this code here, this file here alone that has like fucking thousands of lines apparently, yeah. This one here, if you as one person should review this code, you can probably do that efficiently and reliably in maybe a day, maybe more. It may even take more. I will just put it out there. Maybe in a day you can do this. With your pricks, being efficient, talk to other people and stuff like that. Again, there will probably be code out and say, oh my God, this will take you a week or a month or something like that. But I would say, like, if you just look at the code and you're like, again, coming from the outside in, those are the people we are talking about. When Linux people say more eyes on the code, they mean that more people or people from the external side of the code are looking at the code. So that means that they may not know what the core development team is actually doing right now. They may not know that they already have fixed this bug or this problem. It just needs to be tested and stuff like that. They may not know that the reason why this bug is in there is that if you fix that bug, you gain 10 other bugs. Or the program crashes, so that bug is just going to be there until they figure a way to fix it. That don't break the program and so on and so on. And just because it works on your machine, don't mean that it will work reliably for the program used in other environments and machines and so on and so on. So what I'm trying to say here is that more eyeballs on the code is great, because you know, the more people that can work on a problem, the faster in theory it should be solved. It's not always like that. It's a theory. It's not a fact. It's a theory or a speculation or an opinion. It's not a fact. And also, too many people, you know, too many cooks in the kitchen spoils the food. You can have too many people looking at the code. And if all of those people have not, you know, working code knowledge or minimum code knowledge, not they don't know the best practice, they may read this file here and say, oh, this is wrong. This is not according to our best practices that I've been told. but it's according to the best practices within the project. So you now start and try to fix this and submit it to them, and they're like, no, this is how we do it internally. You do it in another way, that's fine, but this is how we do it internally. So there's so many variables that you as a code reviewer from the outside in, or someone looking at code from the outside in, don't have access to. Can you look at the code? Yes. Can you submit a bug? Yes. Have people done it in the past? Yes, and it's amazing. So yeah, more eyes on the code is only useful if those eyes that are looking on the code understand what the fuck they're doing. If they know what they're doing, if they know what to look for, if they have the knowledge required to basically review the code. Because if you look at the code and want to submit a fix, bug fix and security fix stuff like that, you are a code reviewer. And you need to understand what the fuck you're doing. So think about this when you say more eyeballs on the code is better than not. And remember that the way that open source software works within the core team is exactly the same as a proprietary software works within the core team, development team. The only difference is that we, the public, can see the code on open source and we can't on closed source software. But they work almost the same way as a team within the project. It's just, can we see the code as a public or not? You know, really, really broad stroke pencil here. So go not to the comment section, tear my balls out, tell me I'm a fucking stupid proprietary lover and Bill Gates is paying me off, which is the new one that people are saying they think that Bill Gates is paying a little fucking stupid Danish guy to talk positive about Windows. The bullshit in the community is amazing. Have fun, have a great day, see you all later.